current elevation of this hydrant is now 4212, and just it continues to fill in the rise. What this diagram also shows is these yellow zones are the alluvium, so this kind of loose soil material is still leaving the valley. And there's some, these are basically elevation levels here, but from this mark point here, 4300, to this mark here, 3900, that's 400 feet deep. So as you move to this very, very far point of that, you have to drill down that far at least to find bedrock. And you see question marks here because that's one of the data gaps. We don't know where bedrock is located in every part of the valley. And there's also a couple of site features on here, just for reference, waste rock piles, oxide, kind of, they're not particularly important, but if you have questions about how they affect groundwater, please ask them. Now, this is a cartoon representation of what I was just talking about, the alluvial zones, and it's not a map like these other ones we have posted that are based on true data. This is just an artist's representation of what we mean by different alluvial zones. So on the mine site itself, it appears even these alluvial zones are separated into three distinct layers. And that's because there are some clay layers in between these depositions of soil. And this is also intended to show we put monitoring wells where we think we're going to find contamination, and we try to stick them out at the edges of where we think we're going to find it. It also shows domestic wells, which, you know, for the most part are located in this middle or intermediate zone. But some of them can be in the shallow zone, some of them in the deep zone. And just for point of reference, the deep zone starts at around, I would say about 160, 200 feet below the ground surface is where the deep zone begins. And some of the irrigation wells are located below the deep zone, and they pull a lot of water. So again, this is, to the left is south, to the right is north, and again, kind of a pictorial representation that we're going to refer to later when we talk about the domestic wells and some of the studies we've done. And so this is basically just to give you the setting, and hopefully you'll be able to figure out how to understand some of the science we're going to talk about in the next few slides. And if you have any questions about some of the terminology or some of the concepts, you can certainly ask questions now, or we'd be happy to talk to you using all these maps we have set up around the room. Perhaps at the end of Don's presentation or at the end of So, that being said, I think I'd like to turn the presentation over to Don Thomas, who's also a hydrogeologist, working with CH1 Hill, and John.
But if you can't, just let me know and I'll try to speak more closely to the microphone. So, yeah, one of the purposes of this next component of this presentation is to talk about a recent investigation that was completed, particularly in the area north of the former mine site. And we've compiled all this information into a report that's termed the hydrogeologic framework.
Can't hear you, John.
Okay.
You're going to have to hold the microphone or stand closer.
Let me do this one, so it might make it a little easier. So the hydrogeologic framework assessment is an evaluation study that was done with a couple of different phases starting back in, I think, 2006 or 2007. The second phase of this just wrapped up this last year, and so the results and data have been recently released and are actually still under somewhat some review, but that's what we're going to focus on tonight as we talk. And, you know, before we can really move forward on selecting, determining what a final remedy is going to be for the site to progress innovation, we really have to get a better subsurface, on-site and off-site. So that's the, that was the focus of this hydrogeologic framework assessment. Prior to this investigation, there was really very little known about the subsurface conditions north of mine site. So the information that was collected as part of this investigation is going to help feed into this report and evaluation that's going to the remedial investigation and feasibility study. Those are primary documents in the CERCLA process. That might be a little bit too complicated for right now, but basically that's where remedies get evaluated and selected or recommended as the feasibility study. The information to select those is put in the remedial investigation. So, so what we did to achieve some of these goals, on the right side there, yes, we collected a bunch of injury data. We collected and interpreted a bunch of groundwater information, flow, chemical data, groundwater, evaluated chemical distribution in just the alluvial zone. There were a couple of wells I think installed in the bedrock, but predominantly this effort focused on the alluvial system. There was some fairly sophisticated scientific methods that were used to evaluate water flow, such as tracers. We'll talk a little bit more about that in the next few slides. And some fairly advanced methods to measure changes in water levels over time that we can do on a real-time basis, using things like gigawatts, pressure transducers. So the actual activities that were completed to fulfill that scope were drilling and logging several boreholes around site and off-site. Samples were collected from those boreholes, soil samples, core samples, and those were analyzed within the chemical parameters. Inside of those boreholes, monitoring wells were installed for environmental monitoring purposes for groundwater. And this little list just summarizes in brief the distribution of those wells. And several wells in some instances would be installed in the same borehole, but just at different depths, so they might be monitoring different zones in the groundwater. So from those monitoring wells, groundwater samples were collected and analyzed for chemical analysis. On-site, we've got a much better handle now on what pit lake elevations are doing by having installed some monitoring devices that can give us some real-time data. And also on here, we did some hydraulic testing, which is basically an approach where you can evaluate how groundwater is going to leave in the subsurface by running some tests at individual wells. So this figure just is a layout of where some of those boreholes and monitoring wells were installed as part of this hydrogeologic framework assessment. The left portion of the slide shows the boreholes that were installed in the first phase of the investigation, the right side of the boreholes that were installed in the second phase. And you can see that there were several boreholes installed in wells around the perimeter of the mine site, but predominantly most of the effort was focused on the area north of the mine site. So that's what we're talking about mostly behind. Just to give everybody an overall sense of the scale here, from north to south, it's about 7 miles. So, and from east to west, it's about 4 miles. So this is a real large area, very expansive. So it takes a while to get a good understanding of things on that scale. So from these monitoring wells that were installed, and you might notice from the previous slide that there really wasn't much out there before these wells were installed. So that was one of the main objectives of this hydrogeologic framework assessment. But anyway, when we've got groundwater monitoring wells, we can start taking water level measurements in each one of the wells. And then you start plotting these on a map, kind of like we've done here. So you'll say, well, this at this well of groundwater,